For our second reading today in the Gospel according to Matthew, we pick up again in the account of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount with those who are following him. Jesus was trying to show them and teach them how to live and serve in the world. Many of Jesus' phrases and comments and teachings that we've learned over all the years are very comforting. And underneath a lot of them, and particularly in this passage today, there is a challenge as we face the world and how we try to engage the world and try to be faithful to God through it all. Hear again what the Spirit may say. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist an evildoer, but if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your coat, give your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go also the second mile. Give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, and the word of God within us, thanks be to God. Dear friends, listening to our conversations and observing how we live, it's clear. Personal faith gets fulfilled in how we share community life. We teach and tutor and volunteer all around town. We try to get people jobs, and we care for our workers. We work on bike trails, and we support myriad causes and arts organizations. We heal in body and spirit, we serve meals, we welcome refugees, we care for friends and neighbors, we help people navigate the law, and we try to heal race relations. We celebrate, we lament, we work through news of our city and our nation and our world. And as we sat around last night sharing the joys and concerns in the events of our own lives and world, she said, I really want to know what I can do with the stress. How do I make a difference? It's what the Bible is all about in good times and bad. In the beginning, at creation, the Holy One sets us human ones, people like you and me, in the Garden of Eden to till and to keep it, to nurture balanced and abundant life in all creation. The rest of the story isn't bliss. People mess up. There are consequences. There are circumstances beyond our control, and God loves through it all. Most troubling and transforming times come in wilderness places with no stable community. Think of the Exodus from Egyptian slavery through the desert to a distant, hoped-for land of promise. Or young David and later prophets hid in the hills, fleeing whoever was the current king. Or Israelites conquered and enslaved again in Babylon while a remnant at home lives amid rubble. In those wilderness places of the heart and physical struggle, vision for and commitment to this common life gets formed. That's Moses and the Ten Commandments. That's Isaiah's beautiful vision of lion and lamb in the peaceable kingdom, and Micah's inspiration to do justice, to love kindness, to walk humbly with God. Think of Jesus' birth under the threat, as Luke tells it, of Caesar and Herod, and calling disciples then to walk with him. How he touched people with healing and a hopeful word, and he always said, this is God's reign within and among us. And then the consequence hung on a cross. Think of Paul's letters about how we live together in the risen Christ, continuing his ministry in the world as God wants it to be. And finally, the ultimate revelation of God's reign, a vision of perfection, beauty, safety, abundance in a heavenly city of sanctuary in the very community we love. No question, in Scripture, communion with God entwines intimately in community with others. For me, friends, there is no question that we get that commitment to wider community. We all of us, have a heart for others. In our love for this church and our city, our desire for all people to share goodness in a rich, meaningful, purposeful life, we want to proclaim God's reign, like Jesus, in a broken and fearful world, and to work with others for justice, freedom, peace, as our statement of faith affirms. The real question is, how do we realize that reign of God? How do we get to that common ground as we come with differences in experiences, perspectives, and plans? How do we trust all people belong to God, never separated from God's love, and then not give in to discord and division? How do we live faith together in this sanctuary so that all life everywhere may know that beauty, security, inspiration that we long to feel here at best, that fullness of peace? In recent weeks, we've explored a rule for living faith, more than rules by which we prize or penalize. It's about our regular routines, our priorities, our patterns that flow from the orientation of our hearts. I believe that we need contemplative connection with God. I believe we need accountable relations with others. We need ways to live with creativity, as all of us are gifted. And we need ways, finally today, to live and serve in ways that bring God's order of grace and peace into our world. And friends, it begins with our own personal need for grace and peace. How have we experienced it since our earliest days and memories? For me, in a family of 7 dear, sweet, loving siblings who never said an unkind word, never did an unkind thing, never took advantage of one another, there was order every time we sat down at the table, every time we rotated chores, every time we came to settle some dispute in the parental court. And dogs helped me understand neighborly relations. You see, we loved these 2 little black stray hound lab puppies who wandered up our driveway one day, and then a few years later, when they started snacking on our neighbor's chickens, I saw through prismed tears that it was better for them to be on a farm chasing deer. In college, as a resident assistant, I could not get excited about those bad cop routines, you know, noise, alcohol, girls overnight. But I committed to ordering life for the good of all, which means limits to individual whims. And now, when my own son complains and explains how a test answer counted wrong could be right, but the teacher wouldn't agree, and he chafes under rules that don't make sense, I look in the mirror and know where he gets it. In our adult world, it gets more complicated, but isn't it essentially similar? As we move from personal to communal, how do we order life fairly so all live fully in grace and peace? Have you seen Michael Moore's movie about America learning from other nations? His satirical and sarcastic tone can be too much at times, and some caustic remarks seem unfair or too simplistic. More on that in a minute. Still, do you know that students in Finland have no homework or standardized tests and perform better than anyone else? In Germany and Italy, some of the most productive workers in the world enjoy a 36-hour work week with mandated, legalized, no email after work, and 6 to 8 weeks of vacation. In Norway, violent felons get rehabilitated through low-security programs approximating the routines of everyday life with the lowest recidivism rates. and a parent whose son was killed in a shooting worse than Sandy Hook and Columbine combined argues not for the death penalty or vengeance, but for forgiveness and humane treatment. Moore goes on to interview about women's rights in Tunisia and Iceland, anti-drug programs in Portugal, multi-course gourmet school lunches in France. And in every instance, people say it's about sharing a truly good life with others beyond just myself. Big corporation owners are more concerned about a worker's mother than making more money for themselves. What would you do with it all, she asks. How much do you really need anyway? Teachers stress the importance of poetry and arts and play because it makes kids happy and whole people that maybe they will live into being someday as well. How do we live abundantly in the fullness of grace and peace as God intends? Now, of course, these examples exist within wider webs of socialization and regulation that make each of them possible. And nothing translates from one society directly to another. Otherwise, wouldn't it be nice if we had the Italian sun? Still, if writers of Scripture lived today, what do you think they would say? You see, the ancient Hebrews had laws for everything, from misbehaving animals to workers' rights and dietary laws of what you can eat or not, restrictions. That's Leviticus. As the story goes on in the wilderness, Exodus from Egypt, Moses is chatting with God, he comes out with over 600 commandments, more than just the top 10. It's like Social Security, Health and Human Services, Education, Labor Relations, Food and Drug Administration, all the other government agencies, they're all wrapped up into one. It's called, what we read today, the Holiness Code. And the part that we read is at the core of it all, the heart of it all, the central affirmation we hear again and again, "You shall be holy because I am holy," says the Lord. Out of God's goodness and love, we structure and we nurture everyday life. The verses that Tim read today focus on neighborly relations between rich and poor, powerful and vulnerable, employers and workers, citizens and aliens, speaking truth, living generously, no stealing or exploitation, rather fairness and integrity, no hate, grudges, or vengeance, rather honor, respect, mercy, forgiveness. It all culminates in what Jesus will quote as the greatest commandment, loving neighbor as self. Now, there's a lot more esoteric stuff about haircuts and tattoos that some of us would have trouble with. Still, it sounds a lot like what the Europeans more interviewed and what we Americans aspire to at our best. One phrase a few verses later, just after what Tim read, is even inscribed upon our nation's Liberty Bell: proclaim liberty throughout the land. So God is the Lord of all life, and holy love should guide all our personal decisions, and it includes social regulation, because the biblical people from the ancient Hebrews through Jesus and his disciples to Christians in every age have accepted that we humans don't always choose wisely. We can be selfish and insensitive and unethical. So time after time, the Bible commends what is godly for the good of all in community. How do we bring the order of grace and peace more fully in our world? Now, you may have heard that we Presbyterians like to do things decently and in order. Beyond just screwing in light bulbs, we could joke about how many Presbyterians it takes to decide what light bulbs to buy, when to turn them on, and philosophically, what is light anyway? We are so concerned with order that our Constitution is two volumes, and as one of my seminary professors declared, there's blood on every page. It's not all rules. Most of it is actually just orienting principles. One of my favorite lines reminds us, "We believe there are truths and forms with respect to which people of good characters and principles will differ. So it is a duty both of private Christians and societies to exercise mutual forbearance." You see, friends, as we try to bring God's order for our world, the way we do things, with fairness and respect, honor and humility, grace in and through all grievance, this character matters as much as any content that we may accomplish. Talking about recent events in our nation, he shared concern that varying voices be heard, and he mentioned Parker Palmer's book, Healing the Heart of Democracy. I commend it to you, and I remember doing a study of it years ago with some of you, and so I pulled it off the shelf again this week. Palmer expresses gratitude for how religious traditions like ours have shaped American culture and politics and the commonwealth that has been created. The God who gave us all life wants us to do the same for each other, Palmer urges. Beyond specific words in our sacred texts, the deeper, the more demanding question is, how do we create relationships to bring those words to life, to exemplify what we teach and preach? This witness, he stresses, becomes far more powerful than any particular doctrine. Long before doctrines ever began, in a culture of distrust and fear, strangers would feel compelled to join the first century Christians because they would see how they love one another. Friends, we should not minimize our differences, and nor should we avoid all conversation about such matters. Far from it. Jesus didn't. He lived that conversation even in confrontation. He embodied God's love in new ways. You have heard, Jesus said, an eye for an eye. It's not justifying violence. The ancient Hebrews tried to curb the escalating cycles of revenge by limiting retaliation. Jesus takes that spirit then one step further. As citizens of God's heavenly reign, more than Rome or even religion itself, care for enemies, encourage nonviolent resistance, turn the other cheek, give the cloak to, go the extra mile. It's all about empowering victims to live by God's order of grace more than just acquiesce to unjust laws. Refuse to play the game. Reorder assumptions and reorient hostility to hospitality, aggression to affection. For Jesus, this is no abstract sentimental idea. It's real relationships beyond the boundaries of hurt and hate and insiders and outsiders. You see, when all people become neighbors, then we live that divine nature that we hear decreed in the Old Testament. Be perfect. It really means be complete as God is complete. One scholar explains, perfection does not mean always choosing the right fork at the dinner table. It means loving as God loves with every breath God gives us. Be compassionate as God is compassionate, Mark and Luke say it. Is it impossible? Is it too much? That's when we ultimately see, friends, that the best that we can do is pray. Make me a humble, imperfect channel of God's peace and power and purposes among us. That's when we trust that even amid less than perfect situations in our lives and our world, we can still share a complete, a rich relationship with God and with other people. That's what I like about Anne Lamott. In her own wilderness of drug addiction and family dysfunction and fears about our world, she found Jesus in a Presbyterian church. Her language is also a bit more salty and caustic than I try to be. Still, I appreciate the way that Lamott receives sacred grace amid the disorder of her life and then tries to make a fumbling, faltering difference in response. In the spirit that we just heard outlined and what Jesus urges in all of us, this week I remembered especially her efforts years ago to love a president that she didn't really like very much. In the beginning of that book, Lamott laments all that's going wrong. It's sort of a literary temper tantrum, if you ask me, really. she moves on to her mother's ashes and her dog and her adolescent son and a host of other issues in her community. And eventually she returns to her president by way of Jesus' resurrection, finding a way to rise above the antagonism in her own heart. She promises to pray for her president, in part because she realizes that resentment and hatred she feels can literally kill her. And she writes, "To change the way you feel about people, you have to change the way you treat them. It is so much easier to believe that God hates or disapproves of or punishes the same people we do. But then Jesus ate with even sinners, and his love and mercy fall equally upon us all," she says. "Jesus kept harping on forgiveness and loving one's enemies. So I decided to try." But why couldn't Jesus command us to obsess about everything, to try to control and manipulate people, to stomp away and brood when people annoy us, and then eat a big bag of Hershey Kisses in bed? Dear friends, if we want to find and to make peace in our society and world, like Anne Lamott, we need to begin with ourselves. Surely we all have concerns with our most beloved families and friends and even within ourselves. Some of those concerns arise precisely because we all care deeply for this fullness of life, and yet we differ in all the particulars. No, Jesus does not call us to throw tantrums, to manipulate, to stomp away and brood. Jesus calls us to love all, even enemies, and to resist evil and to rise again by not accepting contentious rules of relationship as the only way to engage one another. Let us speak up about the way we see the world and what we trust God wants for us in Christ, and let us not do so by demonizing and demeaning, for even if we win an argument, we lose ourselves, who we really are, our truest nature of love and compassion. Even when news from all around can seem overwhelming, Jesus empowers us to structure and nurture life as God intends. Trusting God's love will transform us all in ways of grace and peace beyond our imagination. And so even as we may wonder what we can do to make a difference, we go. We serve in the little ways every day that make all the difference in the world. We tutor and teach and volunteer. We connect people with jobs and we care for employees. We care for friends and neighbors and refugees. We heal and serve meals. We work on bike trails. Be perfect. Be compassionate, Jesus said, as God is perfect. Personal faith gets fulfilled in community life, listening to our conversations, observing how we live. It's clear. Thanks be to God. Amen.